Well, of course, I was born and really bred in a place called Fulneck. And it is a quiet place just on the outskirts of Putsey. You see, in Fulneck, we had a minister who was quite an enthusiastic cricketer. And I often would stop him, and I'd have the bat and a ball, and I'd hand him the ball and ask him if he would bowl me a few. And sometimes he used to bowl to me for an hour in the street, using the lamppost as a wicket. So my start was in many ways fairly primitive. But
would you say you were in love with cricket when you were born?
Yes, I had this affection for the game, which gradually deteriorated over the years, but this was when I got involved in Test cricket. See, and Test cricket is pretty tough.
As a 22-year-old Yorkshireman, Len Hutton made 364 for England against Australia in 1938.
8 years ago, I was very fortunate to see Don Bradman get his wonderful score at Leeds, and I little realised that 8 years later I should be in a position to beat it.
When the war came, Hutton was at the height of his powers, but a military accident left him with a shortened left arm.
It was so long becoming sound again that I'd begun to wonder if I ever would play again. It went on for months and months. I had two operations.
Things are on the move in Yorkshire too. At their Headingley ground, the cricket county bring out Len Hutton. Record scorer in Test cricket, he hit up 327 against Australia. Now he's limbering up to a spot of fast bowling from Big Bill Bowes.
Do you think you were as good a player after the war as you were before?
No, I never played the same after the war as I did in 1939. 1939 was my best year. I really felt I was a good player in 1939. I did.
It must be a great regret that sort of 6 years, the best years of your cricketing life, were lost.
Yes, well, there was another chap, Dennis Compton, who was in the same situation. I think we would have both been very outstanding had the war not come.
It wasn't until 1946 that Hutton and Compton were able to test their skills again against the old enemy. They scored runs, but three Ashes series in a row were lost. In Australia in 1946-47, England went down 3-0. And in 1948, Don Bradman's all-conquering team, the Invincibles, overwhelmed England, winning four matches, the other test being drawn. In Australia in 1950-51, despite Hutton's superb form, England lost the series 4-1. English cricket was desperate for success, and despite some establishment opposition, in 1952 appointed Hutton as captain for the series against India, the first professional captain of England in the 20th century.
When I was offered captaincy, I took it, but I wasn't a seeker from these positions. When I was appointed, I wanted to do a good job.
In 1953, the country was only just coming out of the grip of post-war austerity, but the dawn of the new Elizabethan age was lit up by a number of sporting triumphs. 38-year-old Stanley Matthews at last got a Cup winner's medal. The 49-year-old Gordon Richards finally rode a Derby winner on Vidal Sassoon's Pinzer. And then, at the end of the summer, under Hutton's leadership, England won back the Ashes at the Oval after 19 years.
Can you remember what the feeling around the counties was in 1953 when England finally regained the Ashes?
Well, I mean, that was a tremendous lift to everyone, and I was lucky enough to play in that match or in the series.
It rather looked as though we'd never be the Australians. It had gone on and on and on. So when it did happen, it was very pleasant.
The next challenge for the England team was a trip to the Caribbean. Despite the Ashes' success, Hutton was aware that the chairman of selectors, Plum Warner, was not happy with a professional captain leading an MCC tour. Eventually, Lords relented, and Hutton was appointed to lead England in a 5-match series against the West Indies.
Can you remember a mood of optimism as the tour started? Because in 1950, England had been given a thorough beating, really.
It was incredibly badly organised. I mean, I should think the people who picked the side, to pick a manager who had never managed a side before, was a delightful man, but didn't know the West Indies.
Charlie Palmer.
And a very good cricketer, but not the ideal manager. A captain who'd never captained before, Len Hutton, which was a bit of a strain on him. A vice-captain myself, who'd never gone as a vice-captain before. So it was bound to be a bit shambolic.
We flew to Bermuda, and had a week there, played a couple of games.
This is the first England team to fly to an overseas tour, the flights having been paid for by the Bermuda Cricket Association, who are keen to entertain the MCC team. Three gentle warm-up games are played on the Somerset Cricket Ground. Compton and Hutton open on the 19th of December 1953. Compton is bowled by 18-year-old Eugene Woods, who takes 5 for 49 in the match. Almost immediately after the game, Paignton Cricket Club sign Woods for the 1954 English cricket season. Surrey's Peter May and Ken Suttle of Sussex batting together. Left-hander Suttle had been chosen for the tour ahead of Bill Edridge and Colin Cowdery. In MCC's second innings, May scores 48 in a drawn match. After Bermuda, MCC's next port of call is Jamaica. Before the first test, the team are entertained regally by the expat population at Tower Isle Hotel at Ocho Rios Bay on the north coast. Close by, at his clifftop villa, Goldeneye, Ian Fleming is busy writing his third Bond book, Moonraker. Cream boy Dennis Compton frolics in the surf. Johnny Wardle spins Chinaman to the locals. Team cameraman Trevor Bailey.
The first thing that sort of hit you, or hit me anyway, was the number of West Indians who were white, who would come up to me and say, "It won't be worth living if you don't beat them." And I said, why are you living here? I mean, it was ridiculous. I couldn't see this at all.
The first six-day test starts on the 15th of January 1954 at Sabina Park. Both teams are introduced to the Governor of Jamaica, Sir Hugh Foote, brother of Michael Foote. West Indies favouring dark blue for their blazers and caps, rather than the more familiar maroon. The England team is, from the left on the back row, Truman, Statham, Graveney, Moss, May, Locke, and 12th man Suttle. The front row from the right, Watson, Compton, Hutton, Bailey, and Evans. Hutton, having lost the toss for his sixth test in a row, leads his team out. The tall Stollmeyer and the Bayesian Michael Frederick open for the West Indies. Jeff Stollmeyer, the white West Indian captain, was seen very much as the symbol of colonialism. He was booed later in the match for not enforcing the follow-on. Lancashire's Brian Statham bowls to Stollmeyer. The 41-year-old George Headley, on the right, coming out to bat with Clyde Walcott, has been brought back from England where he was playing in the Birmingham League for Walsall.
The people of Kingston had gathered money together and sent it to George on condition he came over, and they had to pick him, actually, in the match.
When he was past his best?
Long way past his best, and in fact Len gave him one off the mark in a test match, which you don't associate with Len, really, do you?
Indeed. That is incredible, isn't it? I was just unthinkable
really
these days.
It really was remarkable. And the first test, they got well on top of us and left us an enormous total to get. And in their second innings, Trevor had gone round the wicket, bowling down on the leg side to stop them scoring and getting too far ahead, which was not a good start to the series. And I think that had a great deal of bearing on the feeling between the teams. It wasn't looked on as cricket, and in those days West Indians enjoyed their cricket, they had fun, and it went against the grain.
After scoring 16 and 1 in the match, Headley retires from international cricket with the third best test average of all time of 60.83. Stollmeyer's decision not to enforce the follow-on is vindicated, West Indies winning by 140 runs. After the tensions of the first test, the MCC players are able to relax on the voyage to Barbados for the next leg of the tour. Football and cricket double international Willie Watson stays on his toes, while fellow Yorkshireman Fred Truman practices his social skills. Dennis Compton bowls to some holidaymakers. Master batsman Compton also took 622 wickets in his first-class career. The reputation of Hutton and the England team already on the slide is worsened in the colony match against Barbados, where the MCC players are criticised for their conduct. On top of which, the Surrey left-arm spinner Tony Locke is no-balled for throwing.
Gary Sobers, playing for Barbados, came in as a 17-year-old got a few runs, and Lockie was on, and he let one go, the old-fashioned chuck, which knocked all three out. And the square leg umpire no-balled him for throwing. The square leg umpire was Clyde Walcott's uncle. But I mean, Lockie cured that in the end. Mm. But
what was the reaction of the rest of the team then? I mean, did
you? We had a bit of a laugh about it, actually. It was only about a colony game.
This is Locke bowling in the Barbados colony match to the teenager Gary Sobers. Hutton loses the toss yet again for the second test, and to make matters worse, he is not well with a chill on his liver. Hutton leads out his team at Bridgetown on the morning of the 6th of February.
Barbados, they had a streaky start. Brian Statham took a couple of wickets early on, and in the end they only got 390, and of which Clyde Walcott got 220. That great big side screen in front of the pavilion, the concrete one, he was hitting it against that and the ball was coming back into the middle. It was a massive innings. And they got into us early. And we lost three wickets quickly. We were about 60 for three, and I went in and I hit the first two from Ramadan firmly, mid-off, mid-on, yard either way, I'd have been eight, not out. And Len came down the wicket to me and he said, we don't want that, you know, we've got to battle it out. So 2 hours later, I was caught and bowled Ramadan off a full toss for 15, which dented out of it. But having said that, they declared and left us a total. And Dennis and I got in towards the end and we were going like trains, and we looked as though we might have an outside chance of winning. And he got an awful LBW decision. And the rest of the batting order collapsed, so we lost easily.
This Beamer bowled at Compton doesn't improve relationships between the two teams. West Indies win by 181 runs. England two down with three to play. Next stop, British Guyana, and criticism of Hutton and the England team is coming from all quarters. Ross Hall of the Daily Mirror said, too many parties were making players jaded. At last, Hutton wins a toss, and he prepares to play a long innings. The third test is played on the mainland of South America, at the border ground, British Guyana. Hutton takes Willie Watson in with him to form an all-Yorkshire opening pair. Watson only scores 12. Compton without the cap and Hutton put on 150 for the third wicket, Compton scoring 64 and Hutton 169. This is excellent film shot by tour manager Charles Palmer of two of England's finest cricketers batting in their contrasting styles. Sonny Ramadan, as always bowling in a cap, had, with left-arm spinner Alf Valentine, bamboozled England in 1950. 5 years later, even the West Indian press are expressing doubts about the legitimacy of Ramadan's action.
He didn't spin it a lot.
No.
But he spun his leg spinner more than his off spinner. And he was very difficult to pick. And of course, as he said, about 5 years ago, he threw every one.
He certainly looks suspicious and still frame.
Well, that's why he had his sleeves rolled down.
So did he throw his off spinner more than his?
No, he threw them both.
What was it like batting with Len Hutton and Dennis Compton? It was more fun batting with Dennis because things amused him as they amused me. Len was much more serious, obviously. But it was a pleasure to bat with him because, I mean, he was a superb player. In fact, they were both tremendous players. Len, of course, was the more correct. Dennis, the more flamboyant.
West Indian all-rounder Dennis Atkinson is bowling to Compton. Atkinson, Ramadan and Valentine bowl 169 overs between them, taking all 10 wickets for 300 runs in England's first innings total of 435. West Indies reply with a first innings score of 251. Brian Statham bowling to Everton Weeks. Weeks celebrates his 29th birthday on the 26th of February, the third day of the test. England's spinners do the bulk of the bowling. This is Laker. Johnny Wardle, wrist spin. And Tony Locke, orthodox left arm spin, bowling to Weeks. Everton Weeks is bowled by Locke for 94. And next ball, Atkinson is caught and bowled. The main incident in the West Indies' first innings is the run out of the local man, wicketkeeper Clifford McWatt.
We had a few problems with umpiring and that sort of thing because the management objected to one of the umpires who was going to stand in British Guiana, and they replaced him with the groundsman who gave a run out decision, which was absolutely right. He was out by a yard and a half, and then we had a riot.
Yeah, the bottle throwing.
Yes, the bottle throwing, and
was that
they had the mounted police out and batons and everything. And
was that alarming or amusing?
Frightening.
Was it?
Frightening.
Mr. W.S. Jones, president of the British Guiana Board of Control, came on the field to talk to Hutton.
He came out onto the field during the riot and said to Len, he said, Len, you ought to take your players off. Len turned around him and said, no, I want another wicket.
Yeah, because you'd taken three quite quickly.
We'd taken three quite quickly. And I shall never forget it because the next man in was Sonny Ramadan. And as he walked behind the president, he said, and you can have mine if you bowl a straight one. Because he was terrified.
Was he?
Oh, everybody was.
This is the tail end of the West Indies' second innings. They're all out for 256, leaving England just 75 to win. Hutton has sent in May and Graveney to knock off the runs. Graveney shows his frustration at some leg theory. May is out for 12, but Graveney and Watson ensure a 9-wicket victory, finishing with some pleasing strokes after lunch on the sixth and final day. The players and umpires leave the field well protected by the British Guiana police force. This win is the turning point of the tour. E.W. Swanton saying that England looked a different side from the one that had lost the first two tests. Hutton received a congratulatory telegram from the MCC, and Johnny Wardle said it was Len Hutton's victory. Enjoying some well-earned time off before the fourth test, Peter May snaps away while Dennis Compton, rather unwisely, tries some water skiing on legs weakened by a number of knee operations.
Whose heart is aching for breaking its vow? Who's sad and blue? Who's crying too? Just like I cried over you. Right to the end, just like a friend.
The fourth test starts on the 17th of March at the Queen's Park Oval in Port of Spain, Trinidad, on a matting wicket. West Indies win the toss and predictably choose to bat. There is controversy on the first morning of the match. England thought they had got West Indies opener Holt out.
And JK went to square drive it, and it hit that high up the bat, and I caught it there and just turned to walk off because I knew it was the last ball before lunch.
Yeah.
And I hear Len at mid-off saying, "Well, how was that then?" And Dennis turned to Ellis Atchon and said, "Give him out, Ellis." And he said, "No, not out." I threw the ball away.
Do you reproach yourself years later for chucking the ball down, despite the provocation?
I'm a fairly level sort of bloke, and I just couldn't help myself.
Yeah.
No, I'm not sorry I did it.
The umpires later complained to Hutton about remarks made to them by some England players. In this sequence, Weeks and Worrall are batting together. Weeks is the shorter of the two. In the West Indies total of 681 for 8, the three W's, Everton Weeks, Frank Worrall and Clyde Woolcott, all born in the tiny island of Barbados,